Donc, oui, tiens.
President, please be seated.
Veuillez vous asseoir.
The court is now in session.
Je déclare l'audience ouverte.
Today the chamber will hear the testimony of a witness that is through TCW 851. And before we commence the hearing of the witness,
avant de commencer d'entendre le témoin,
the chamber will conduct a brief hearing on oral arguments and submissions on the evidence
au sujet des
tainted with the torture,
extorqué sous la torture
in the proceedings in case 02/02. And Ms. Sekolbote, please report the attendance of the parties and other individuals at today's proceedings. Sekolbote, Mr. President, for today's proceedings, all parties to this case are present.
Au procès sont présentes.
Mr. Nunji is present in the holding cell downstairs. He has waived his right to be present in the courtroom.
Il a renoncé à son droit d'être physiquement présent.
The waiver has been delivered to the greffier.
A été remis au greffier.
A witness who is to testify today, that is through TCW 851, confirms that through his best knowledge, the witness has no relationship by blood or by law to any of the two accused, that is Nunji and Kyu Sampon, or to any other civil parties admitted in this case. The witness took an oath before the Iron Club statue this morning. Thank you. President, thank you.
Merci.
The chamber now decides on the request by Nunji. The chamber has received a waiver from Nunji dated 25th May 2015, which notes that due to his health, that is headache, back pain, he cannot sit or concentrate for long, and in order to effectively participate in future hearings, he requests to waive his right to participate in and be present at the 25th May 2015 hearing. He advises that his counsel advised him about the consequence of this waiver, that in no way it can be construed as a waiver of his right to be tried fairly or to challenge evidence presented or admitted to this court at any time during this trial. Having seen the medical report of Nunji by the duty doctor for the accused at the ECCC, dated 25th May 2015, who notes that Nunji has a chronic back pain when he sits for long and recommends that the chamber shall grant him his request so that he can follow the proceedings remotely from the holding cell downstairs. Based on the above information and pursuant to Rule 81.5 of the ECCC internal rules, the chamber grants Nunji his request to follow today's proceedings remotely from the holding cell downstairs via audiovisual means. The AV unit personnel are instructed to link the proceedings to the room downstairs so that Nunji can follow it remotely. That applies for whole day. And the chamber would also like to inform the parties and the public that this week, the International Reserve Judge Korobkin,
juge international de réserve,
has some other personal matters and he cannot attend the proceedings. The chamber would like to give the floor to the parties to provide oral observations regarding the submissions of the attempted torture evidence during the proceedings, the substantive proceedings in case 002. And first, the chamber would like to hand the floor to the co-prosecutors and the lead co-lawyers for civil parties, and the total time of 30 minutes is given to the two teams. You may proceed, the co-prosecutor.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good morning, Your Honors. We believe that the issue that to be discussed this morning is very critical in this case, where torture plays such a key role. It was a key feature of the Khmer Rouge regime. And we've already seen in the evidence, torture was the basis by which people were identified, arrested, and then eventually executed. The issue before this court this time is how evidence derived from torture, evidence that came up, statements that came up only because of torture, will be treated in this court. This court, we believe, and I think all parties agree, is bound by the Convention Against Torture of 1987. To which Cambodia is a party. That provides in Article 15 for an exclusionary rule on the use of statements derived from torture. Article 15 states that each state party shall ensure that any statement which is established to have been made as a result of torture shall not be invoked as evidence in any proceeding except against a person accused of torture as evidence that the statement was made. Your Honors know that in this case, both Q Sampan and Nguyen Chia are accused of torture. That's one of the charges in this case. In interpreting the convention, of course, it's important to understand the purpose of that. And what we agree on with the Nguyen Chia's submission is that the primary purpose of the Convention Against Torture is to stop torture, to deter it. In fact, in its preamble, the convention talks about this and says it is because of desiring to make more effective the struggle against torture and other cruel, inhumane, or degrading treatment or punishment throughout the world that the convention was entered into. So, the reasons to exclude evidence derived from torture, there are two basic reasons. The first is it's inherently unreliable. When people are being tortured, when they're being starved, beaten, electrocuted, drowned in water, forced to eat feces, they can be expected to say anything to please the torturer in order to end the torture. So it's simply unreliable to take that as evidence that proves the truth of the matter that the victim confesses to. But there's a second reason, and that's the primary reason that this convention was entered into, and that is to deter torture. The objective of the convention and the exclusionary rule is to prevent authorities, governments, armed groups from having an incentive to torture people in order to obtain evidence, or in this case, propaganda. Because what the evidence has already shown and will continue to show in this case is that the victims of torture by the Khmer Rouge at places like Krang Tachan and S21, they were not being tortured to obtain evidence for a trial. Nguyen Chia and the leadership of the Khmer Rouge gave no trial to any of their victims. They were being tortured in order for the regime to obtain propaganda to justify its actions, to justify its executions and persecutions of its own population. And that is exactly the purpose that Nuncio wants to use that evidence for in this trial. It's not, I hope he realizes, a legal defense. Even if you have someone confess to being a spy, you cannot, under international law, execute a spy without a trial. But he's trying to use it to give a justification for propaganda, for public propaganda purposes. Maybe he thinks somehow it helps him in the trial and diminishes his guilt. So, what we find offensive is that Nuncio is attempting to take statements from people who were electrocuted, who were starved, who were beaten and degraded, some had their fingernails pulled out, and take confessions that they made under that torture and present it to the public as this is evidence that our regime had enemies, that all of these people we killed, we had a right to kill them. We were right to kill them because they were KGB, CIA, UN spies. What he's wanting to do is to use the torture evidence for exactly the reason that they tortured the people in S21. Now, this is not an issue in this case where the court has to decide, can an accused ever use evidence from torture where the accused person has nothing to do with the torture taking place? One can imagine circumstances where one accused wants to use evidence that was obtained by torture, that he had nothing to do with it, that law enforcement tortured someone, and he had nothing to do with it. In that case, there's still a problem of reliability, but there's no reason to worry about providing an incentive for further torture, because the law enforcement that committed the torture, and they are not benefiting. Here, the very people responsible for the torture are attempting to benefit from it. And when I say that, there's already evidence on the record, and your honors will hear more. Nuncio was fascinated with torture. He told Tetsamba, we know that he studied for over 2 years in Vietnam, made many trips to Vietnam. He told Tetsamba that he enjoyed reading Vietnamese books about torture and the arrest of communist members. He also admitted to Tetsamba, to his friend, very close friend Tetsamba, that when discussing confessions, quote, they normally confessed when they were beaten painfully and seriously tortured. And Nuncio told Tetsamba, he confirmed Deutsch's statement, that he became the de facto head of S21. That's on page 85 of Tetsamba's book. So in this case, it's very clear that the one party that's asking to be able to use torture evidence for the truth of the matter, Nuncio, because Kyusampan, the civil parties, and the prosecution do not say we want to use evidence derived from torture or result of torture for the truth of the matter. The one party that wants to use evidence derived from torture for the truth of the matter is the very person responsible for the torture that took place. Frankly, Your Honors, we're not very worried that you're going to allow that to happen. Nuncio has taken a completely different position now than he took in the first trial. In the first trial, he took the position that Your Honors should exclude any evidence derived from torture for the truth of the matter. He's reversed himself, and he's appealing Your Honors' decision for doing exactly what he asked you to do. However, we also think, because torture is so key to this case, so key to the way that Khmer Rouge acted. There is important evidence that comes out of or is related to statements made when people were detained and tortured that should be admitted, not for the truth of the matter, but to prove other facts. For example, we have some examples, quite a few examples in our pleading, and I'm not going to repeat all of them, but let me discuss one that's not in our pleading. We know that Doik has testified that he came to Nunchia with a confession and told him one of the very high leaders has been implicated. Kyu Sampan has been implicated in an S21 confession. And Doik said Nunchia told him to bury that, to make sure that no one saw that and that he didn't come back anymore with evidence against Kyu Sampan. And this is confirmed 100% in Tet Sambat's interviews with Nunchia. Nunchia says exactly the same thing. He says Doik came to him with a confession implicating Kyu Sampan, and he said, quote, this is page 82 of Behind the Killing Fields. Nunchia told Doik, quote, don't report this again and don't say it again. So what does the prosecution want to offer that evidence for? We're not offering it because we believe that Kyu Sampan was an opponent of Pol Pot and Nunchia. Just the opposite. He was in the very inner circle, trusted inner circle. And in fact, these facts that I've just discussed prove that. It shows that Nunchia saw Kyu Sampan as in that inner circle that had to be protected, the very core of the Khmer Rouge. It also shows, yet again, that Nunchia knew that these confessions under torture really were not reliable at all to prove the truth. He didn't question for a second that it was true. So he knew that they were torturing people to obtain untrue information. And finally, it absolutely shows again Nunchia's control over Doik and the whole S21 torture and killing machine, because he was able to give instruction to Doik. Even when there was a statement implicating a high-level accused, bury it. I don't want to see it again, and don't come back anymore with information like this. So this is extremely relevant information that comes out of the statement. Undoubtedly, the person who made that was tortured, but it's not being offered for the truth. Just the opposite. It's being offered to show matters. We say it is untrue, and to show matters, these other issues that I've talked about. Now, the defense in this case has. This issue arose because of certain questions that were put to witnesses that we say quite clearly were derived from S21 confessions. I want to go through briefly the two concrete examples in the defense pleading. The first was when witness Pech Ching was testifying. He had been a member of the District 105 Tramcock Committee and later sent to a rubber plantation in the North Zone. And the defense asked him if he was aware that someone who had been a detainee, a victim of S21, had implicated Pech Chim and his brother as belonging to his network. What's the relevance of whether the witness was aware of that other than to show that supposedly Sai had a network and that Pech Chim was a member? It was offered for the truth of the matter. Now, the defense may say that though they didn't ask him if it was true, I only asked him if you were aware. Well, there's no relevance to whether he was aware of it. Certainly the defense was entitled to ask Pech Chim, were you a member of Sai's network? Were you a member of a network opposing the regime? They could have asked that question. No one would have stopped them. But it's a problem when publicly Nunchia wants to give evidence put before the public that people who were died, who were tortured and executed, were traitorous agents of foreign governments, taking that completely out of context without presenting to the public the context in which this evidence was derived through torture. The second example was during the testimony of Ye Boon, and I believe she was asked, were you aware, the defense wanted to read to her a statement of another S-21 detainee talking about the character of certain people she worked with. Again, the defense could simply have asked Ye Boon about the character of those people. There would be no objection from the prosecution for that. If the confession said these people were incompetent, the defense could have asked Ye Boon, do you believe they were incompetent? If the confession said these people were particularly brutal, and that was the point that counsel wanted to get to, he could have asked Ye Boon, were these people particularly brutal, and gotten her answer. Instead, what was clear is it was an attempt to backdoor, to get into evidence or before the public, torture evidence, without doing so directly. So there are many reasons, Your Honors, we believe where evidence that's related to detainees' statements can come in. We've indicated those in our filings, for example, things about the type of people targeted. In the Krangtachan interrogator's notebooks, for example, it indicates many times that this individual was arrested, he was a Lon Nol second lieutenant, or this individual, her husband, was a Lon Nol major. Indications like that. The prosecution finds it important to put that before you, not to prove. It's irrelevant to us whether or not, in fact, the person was a second lieutenant or the husband was a major. What's important is the Khmer Rouge believed it, and it was for this reason that they were targeted. So regardless of the truth of the matter, these statements in the notes of the interrogators prove the targeting of Lon Nol officers and the policy of the Khmer Rouge. Another example, in many cases, we see people arrested for stealing fruit, for stealing food, hungry people. Again, it's irrelevant to us whether or not that is true. We're not offering it to prove that someone stole a banana or a papaya. We're offering it to prove the brutality of the regime that would arrest and often torture people because of such a trivial offense when they were committed by people who were starving. Similarly, many of the confessions record ethnicity or a person's links to Vietnam, that they were Khmer Krom, or that they came from Khmer Kampuchea Krom. Again, whether or not they really were from Vietnam is irrelevant to us. It proves again the persecution of all those that the Khmer Rouge viewed as in any way related to Vietnam at that time. I don't believe I have anything else to add. And unless you have questions, I'd be happy to address any issues that would be helpful to you. I believe my civil parties have 5 minutes of arguments.
Le Président. I have two questions and at least
La juge Fenn a la parole. expect the other parties to give their opinion on that too.
J'aimerais poser deux questions. So I'll start with this one.
You haven't touched on it now in your oral submission, but talked about it in the written one.
Vous en avez parlé brièvement.
Article 15 says, talks about the statement which is established to have been made as a result of torture. Now my question goes to the standard of what is established and to the time when this should happen. Now to shorten this a bit, let me see if I understood your submission correctly and then let me ask the question. When it comes to standards, you mentioned a couple of them. I don't think you made a final determination, provided we don't read it together with the time you consider as the one when to establish it, and that would be the verdict, and that would mean beyond a reasonable doubt. Did I understand you correctly?
No, Your Honor, because the beyond the reasonable doubt standard would apply to evidence that was, well, only to evidence that's necessary for prove guilt. So if the prosecution was using a statement and the guilt of the accused depended on that statement being admitted, then I would agree we would have to show beyond a reasonable doubt that the statement was not a result of torture. But in other circumstances, I believe this is an open question, I don't know of jurisprudence, but I think the standard would either be that the proponent show by a preponderance of the evidence, or alternatively, and perhaps this would be better, by clear and convincing evidence, that the statement was not a result of torture. And let me just add one comment on what is torture, because in the Q Sampan submission, for example, they said, well, Vong Sarun, who testified last week, shows that not every statement in Krang Tachan came from torture. She wasn't tortured. I disagree 100% with that submission. Torture is defined by the convention as physical, severe physical or mental harm. Vong Sarun was arrested for reasons she didn't know after her husband had disappeared. She was taken with her one-year-old child. She was shackled. She was provided very little food. Her baby was crying for lack of food and was beaten. Then she was taken after a week to interrogation. When she got to that moment of discussing sitting in the chair in the interrogation, even here in this courtroom, 37 years later, anyone in the courtroom realized the severe mental stress she was under. So there's no question in my mind that this is a perfect example of a person who was a victim of torture. She was threatened with a branch. Eventually, she didn't say anything. She was extremely fortunate. Unlike so many thousands of others at Krang Tachan, she wasn't tortured or killed. But I think in these types of circumstances, in her case, for example, if she had made a confession and the party wanted to use that for the truth of the matter during that interrogation, in my view, it would have been the result of torture.
So, to get back to my original question, as to standards, you don't have a clear view beyond not to a reasonable doubt. Let me get back to time. You seemed to argue that this determination can only be made at the end, after all the evidence has been heard. Now, if this is true, don't we end up with the issue of what I would now call, for lack of another applicable concept in civil law, fruit of the poisonous tree. If we allow statements that might have been obtained under torture to be used, for instance, to confront the witness with it and that leads to further statements, etc., how would you suggest to deal with this issue? And again, the fruit of the poisonous tree doctrine is something which is alien to civil law systems.
Thank you. Obviously, the modalities are complex, but I would not say that this could be used to confront a witness. This is exactly how it was attempted to be used by the defense.
That gave rise to this hearing.
And in those situations, it shouldn't be taken out of context and a witness confronted with it. Very, very little is gained. And as Your Honor points out, then we have on the record this evidence that Your Honors may very well determine at the end of the day was a result of torture.
So,
but what I'm saying is that the final determination, for example, there's no need to confront witnesses with this, but if there are confessions that Nunchia believes should be offered into evidence, we should have a separate, at the appropriate time, a separate document hearing where we hear the reasons why he believes these statements were not the result of torture
or,
in that case, because I don't believe the court should ever admit a statement offered for the truth of the matter that was a result of torture.
And the last question, just to help me understand some of your arguments. Now, obviously, we cannot deal with each and every case that will come up. It will be very much an issue of case-to-case basis. But I wanted to take up the example you mentioned with the banana. So what you said, if I understand you correctly, it should be possible, for instance, to use this question on whether somebody had stolen bananas, not to prove that he or she has stolen bananas, but to prove that the regime was cruel. But isn't that semantics? I mean, in order to prove that the regime is cruel, obviously you have, you will argue because they even killed people who stole bananas. So where is the line?
Well, I think the line is clear. The convention was put forward to prosecute people that commit torture. And torture is either to obtain information or as punishment. So when people are tortured as punishment for stealing a banana, this is a crime, and it's irrelevant. It's quite clear. We don't care whether it's true that they stole the banana or not. I don't think that's mere semantics. It's absolutely clear and that it's irrelevant to our case whether they were a thief of bananas or coconuts or not. I think absolutely the convention would be frustrated if this type of evidence, which proves the torture and proves the cruelty, the very charges against the people responsible for the torture were excluded.
Et il faut pouvoir accuser les personnes
I
qui
don't think
ont
you have really answered my question because I didn't argue that all the evidence had to be excluded. I came down to a specific example and to this issue of to prove the truth of the matter. But I take your answer. Thank you, that's all from me at the moment.
Ce que vous avez dit par rapport au fait de prouver la vérité. Mais bien, j'ai compris et je vous remercie, j'en ai terminé pour l'instant. Le Président, le juge Lavergne a la parole.
Oui, merci Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr.
Peut-être tout d'abord une observation.
I would like to start by making a remark.
Il me semble important de souligner que beaucoup de confessions obtenues, que ce soit à S21 ou à Krimpanchan, ont déjà été déclarées recevables et sont donc déjà admises au dossier.
That is to say that they have already
been admitted. Ce qui me paraît par contre important aujourd'hui, c'est la discussion quant à l'utilisation que l'on peut faire de ces documents. Donc je pense qu'il y a des questions de terminologie qui sont ici importantes, parce que parfois on parle d'exclusion des éléments de preuve, mais je pense que cette exclusion ne concerne pas une question de recevabilité en tant que telle. C'est une exclusion, me semble-t-il, par rapport aux normes qui s'appliquent. Et la norme clé, me semble-t-il, ainsi que vous l'avez dit, c'est l'article 15 de la Convention contre la
torture.
Et je voudrais être sûr d'avoir compris ce que vous nous dites. Il me semble que quand il s'agit de déclarations faites dans des conditions inhumaines, dégradantes ou sous la torture, ce qui est important de distinguer, c'est ce qui va, ce qui est censé permettre d'établir la vérité d'un certain nombre de faits énoncés par la personne soumise à cette torture ou à ces traitements. Et il y a aussi, en tant que fait, en tant que tel, la déclaration de la personne qui dit « telle personne faisait partie de mon réseau ». Ça, c'est un fait. Et ce fait, éventuellement, il peut être intéressant parce qu'on peut savoir qu'ultérieurement, cette personne qui a été désignée dans cette déclaration a été par la suite arrêtée.
Donc,
il y a différents, peut-être, niveaux dans l'utilisation des éléments de preuve. Il y a le cœur qui est la vérité de la déclaration faite et il y a simplement le fait d'une énonciation. Je ne sais pas si je suis assez clair, mais est-ce que vous, ce que vous nous dites aujourd'hui, c'est que il nous faut faire cette distinction entre certains éléments purement factuels qui sont, qui peuvent être relevés dans une déclaration, à savoir que telle et telle personne ont été mentionnées dans la déclaration, ou le fait que telle personne a été accusée de tel crime, mais qu'on doit négliger tout ce qui concerne la vérité de ces déclarations. Est-ce que c'est bien cela ce que l'on doit comprendre ce matin?
Is that what I should understand from your submissions this morning?
Your Honor, I believe you have understood my submissions.
Monsieur le juge,
I think
j'ai dit l'accusation. Je pense
we are
que vous
very
avez très
fortunate
bien compris mes arguments.
That we're in a civil law system
nous
with professional
dans un système
judges.
De droit civil avec des juges professionnels.
So admissibility in
par
systems that have, for example, juries is a very key question because, as we often say, you can't unring the bell of a jury. It's very hard to tell a jury to consider evidence for one purpose but not for another. But with professional judges, I think
c'est professional judges are very often required to do just that.
So in this case, as Your Honor points out, it's
impossible
to understand the purges of the Khmer Rouge without understanding how people were forced to provide long lists of names, of strings, of accomplices, and then those people were subsequently arrested. So the fact that people are named in those strings explains their arrest and can be considered for that purpose. But as a professional judge, if you determine that statement was made under torture, then it's your responsibility, and I don't think this is so difficult, not to consider that for the truth of the matter. The fact that the person had their fingernails pulled out and then said all of these people were part of my network of KGB and CIA network that was established 20 years ago, you can simply disregard that, both because it should be excluded under the, it must be excluded under the torture convention.
Ces éléments doivent être exclus dans le cadre de la convention contre la torture.
Thank you,
le président,
international
merci.
Co-prosecutor.
Merci, monsieur le co-procureur
the floor
international.
Is now given to the lead co-lawyer
la parole est à présent
au
co-avocat pour les parties civiles.
Je vous remercie, monsieur le président.
Thank
bonjour
you,
à tous.
President. Good morning, everyone.
Je vais être très brève, monsieur le président, m'en référer en grande partie à nos écritures et me concentrer sur le point qui semble particulièrement intéresser la Chambre aujourd'hui, à savoir la distinction à faire entre la véracité des informations contenues dans les confessions et le reste des informations et le moment à partir duquel cette question doit être traitée. En préambule, je voulais simplement expliquer pourquoi nous avons pris position sur ce débat et expliquer les parties civiles qui sont directement concernées par cette question en indiquant à la Chambre, aux parties et également au public que nous avons quatre parties civiles qui ont été admises par les co-juges d'instruction ou par la chambre préliminaire pour avoir été victimes directes de crimes commis à S21 Nous représentons dans le cadre du collectif 125 parties civiles qui ont été admises pour avoir souffert indirectement de crimes commis à S21 et notamment des crimes de torture, et que dans notre collectif de parties civiles, nous avons 11 parties civiles qui ont souffert directement ou indirectement de crimes commis à Klan Taichan et notamment des crimes de torture. Et c'est donc notamment en leur nom que nous prenons la parole aujourd'hui. La façon dont nous avons procédé pour écrire notre mémoire est très simple. Nous avons repris les différentes décisions de la Chambre, qu'il s'agisse de décisions écrites ou de décisions orales, en remontant jusqu'au cas numéro 1, lors duquel la Chambre s'est prononcée de manière substantielle et détaillée sur cette question. Et nous en sommes arrivés à une conclusion que je souhaiterais partager avec vous aujourd'hui. La conclusion, c'est tout d'abord que les principes sont clairs et que les règles relatives à l'admissibilité et à l'utilisation des preuves obtenues sous la torture ont été parfaitement discutées et comprises par la Chambre dès le dossier numéro 1 et dans le respect de l'article 15 de la Convention contre la torture. Il nous semble donc que la Chambre a d'ores et déjà considéré que les éléments de preuve obtenus sous la torture ne peuvent pas être utilisés pour la véracité de leur contenu contre un accusé ou par un accusé. Il nous semble que cette question dont vous nous avez parlé, Monsieur le juge Laverne, ce matin, c'est une question sur laquelle la Chambre s'est déjà penchée et sur laquelle elle s'est déjà engagée. Et la raison pour laquelle je dis ça, c'est qu'en relisant votre décision sur la recevabilité des éléments de preuve dans le cas numéro 1, il semble clair que vous ayez considéré que les 60 confessions de S21 qui avaient été présentées par le procureur étaient certes admises et faisaient partie dès lors du dossier, mais qu'elles n'étaient pas admises pour la véracité de leur contenu. Cette décision pour nous est fondamentale pour comprendre la façon dont la Chambre a d'ores et déjà traité la question des confessions de S21. Nous considérons que cette décision sur la recevabilité des confessions de S21 dans le dossier 1 crée de fait ce que nous considérons être une présomption que les confessions de S21 ont été établies sous la torture. Il nous semble que cette présomption, est renforcée par le jugement du dossier 2.1, désormais définitif, dans lequel la pratique de la torture à S21 a été largement documentée. C'est notre position aujourd'hui, nous sommes une partie, nous avons lu les décisions de la Chambre et c'est la conclusion que nous avons tirée de la lecture de ces documents. Alors maintenant, quelles sont les conséquences pratiques pour le dossier 2.2? Nous considérons qu'il existe une présomption que les confessions, et je me réfère plus particulièrement aux confessions de S21 puisque c'est le cœur du problème aujourd'hui, nous considérons que la Chambre a établi une présomption que les confessions de S21 ont été établies sous la torture. Et nous tirons cette conclusion de la décision sur la recevabilité des confessions elles-mêmes. Comment les parties doivent finalement se débrouiller avec cette présomption? Eh bien, il nous semble que si une partie souhaite utiliser les informations contenues dans une confession pour la véracité de ces éléments, eh bien, elle doit faire une demande à la Chambre pour renverser cette présomption. Nous considérons dès lors que ce qui s'est passé en audience il y a quelques semaines lorsque le conseil de Nunchia a souhaité se référer au contenu d'une confession sans préalablement avoir demandé l'autorisation de la Chambre est inappropriée. La façon dont nous lisons et dont nous comprenons les décisions de la Chambre depuis le dossier 2.1, c'est qu'à partir de maintenant, si une partie, quelle qu'elle soit, souhaite se référer au contenu d'une confession pour la véracité des informations contenues dans cette confession, elle doit faire une demande à la Chambre afin que la Chambre et la Chambre elle seule puissent mener un certain nombre d'investigations sur les conditions dans lesquelles cette confession en particulier a été réalisée. Il faut donc que les parties suivent le règlement intérieur de cette Cour et fassent une requête sur le fondement de l'article 93-1 dans laquelle cette partie, encore une fois, quelle qu'elle soit, puisse expliquer pourquoi il est utile à la manifestation de la vérité que les conditions dans lesquelles la confession a été réalisée soient étudiées et pourquoi il est opportun que cette requête soit faite maintenant à l'audience, alors que bien évidemment, toutes les parties avaient la possibilité de faire de telles requêtes au moment de l'instruction. J'espère avoir du coup répondu aux questions qui ont été posées en amont par le juge Fens et par le juge Laverne. Pour récapituler, il nous paraît bien évidemment évident qu'il y a une distinction à faire entre les informations contenues dans les confessions qui sont utilisées ou qui seraient utilisées par les parties ou d'ailleurs par la Chambre pour la véracité des informations et le reste. Donc cette distinction nous paraît pertinente, nécessaire et nous semble découler de l'article 15 de la Convention contre la torture. Et sur les implications pratiques de ce principe, nous considérons que la Chambre a d'ores et déjà posé une présomption que les confessions de S21 avaient été réalisées sous la torture et que dès lors, il incomberait à chacune des parties de solliciter la Chambre par le biais d'une demande en vertu de l'article 93.1 pour que la Chambre, le cas échéant, puisse conduire une enquête ou une investigation sur les conditions précises dans lesquelles la confession aurait été obtenue. Je vous remercie, Monsieur le Président.
I thank you, Mr. President.
So what about documents that are not coming from S21, but for instance from Krangtachan Security Center?
Qui viendrait par exemple du centre de sécurité de Krangtachan?
And in this context, do you have any clear views on the standards?
Et avez-vous un avis bien clair quant aux normes? Je pose la même question que celle que j'ai posée au procureur. Je parle des normes par rapport à
what standards are to be used to fulfill the requirement of established to have been made under torture.
Sur le standard, non, nous nous en référons à la Chambre sur ce point. Il nous apparaît qu'il ne nous incombe pas de nous prononcer sur ce point. Nous nous en référons à la sagesse de la Chambre et nous n'avons pas dans notre soumission écrite fait de proposition là-dessus. Il nous paraît, bien évidemment, sur votre première question, que les confessions obtenues à Krataychan devraient suivre le même sort que celles qui ont été obtenues à S21. Donc la présomption dont nous avons parlé et qui existerait pour les confessions de S21 devrait nécessairement s'appliquer aux confessions obtenues à Krataychan.
Le président,
you may now proceed,
le juge Lavergne a la parole.
Oui, je voudrais insister un tout petit peu sur cette idée de présomption. Je n'ai pas entendu, et vous me corrigerez si je me trompe, mais je n'ai pas entendu que cette présomption serait basée sur le principe de l'autorité de chose jugée.
Of the res judicata, because the accused in this trial are not the same as in the first trial,
so argument puisse être valable.
I don't think, therefore, that this argument can stand.
Juridiquement, legally speaking, les fondements
what would be the foundations of the presumption?
Et puis, il y a un principe général qui est celui du principe as well, du which is the principle fardeau de la preuve.
Of the burden of the proof, the onus of the proof.
Appartient à,
and the onus of the proof
au procureur.
Is on the prosecution.
En établissement
so,
une présomption,
by establishing a presumption,
si
especially since this presumption is
not,
does not have a clear legal base, wouldn't we, in this case, reverse the onus of the proof by imposing, therefore, the onus on the defense in this case?
Je vais essayer de répondre,
I'm going to try to answer
Monsieur
this, Your Honor.
En expliquant la
by
façon dont
explaining
nous avons
the way
procédé,
that we have proceeded, we have read your
decisions. And it's by reading your decisions that,
and of course, in view of case 1 as well,
because the decision of
admissibility in case 2 is less precise, we considered that you had considered that there was a presumption
that the confessions at S21
had been established under torture.
La raison pour laquelle and the reason nous sommes arrivés à cette conclusion,
we arrived at this conclusion is that you admitted
les confessions de S21,
S21 confessions,
à la condition, je cite ici de mémoire votre décision,
under the condition,
à la condition que celle-ci ne soit pas admise pour la véracité de leur contenu. Donc nous sommes véritablement partis de votre jurisprudence pour essayer d'établir notre position.
Build our position.
Maintenant, je dois dire
now,
à la Chambre et aux parties que nous sommes parfaitement ouverts sur cette question. J'ai expliqué les raisons pour lesquelles nous avions soumis nos observations. C'est parce que nous avons un nombre important de parties civiles dans le collectif qui sont directement concernés par cette question. Maintenant, nous en remettons
now,
à l'appréciation de la Chambre sur le point dont vous parlez, Monsieur le juge.
Bien, alors.
Fine. Judge
ce n'est pas une question, mais une observation. J'observe que
question,
il y a un certain nombre de juridictions qui se sont prononcées sur ce problème,
that have
notamment
ruled on
il y a
this issue.
Des arrêts de la Cour
For example,
européenne des droits de l'homme
there are decisions from the European Court of Human Rights that seem interesting in this regard, and in which it seems
qui pourrait être
that one of the standards that could come from this.
C'est le
but
fait
of course, I'll let the parties judge this.
Is that there is a serious risk that torture was used?
I'm referring in particular to a case,
El Aski
versus Belgium,
et paragraphe
and in paragraph
89
of the decision in particular.
Juste pour rebondir, Monsieur le juge, il me semble que je n'ai pas encore relu notre écrit, mais il me semble que cette notion de risque substantiel a été fait partie des notes de bas de page que nous avons inclus dans notre soumission
in
et que, pour être très clair, cette notion de risque substantiel pourrait s'appliquer de manière tout à fait pertinente
in a
perfectly au cas d'espèce.
Relevant way in this case here.
Thank you. The chairman would like now to hand the floor to the defense teams first, to the defense team for Nguyen Chi. Counsel, you can proceed.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council. From two questions from the Nguyen Chi defense to two separate witnesses, we have now, it seems, into a discussion about the all permissible uses of potentially tortured, tainted evidence in this trial. We believe that 15 or 20 minutes that we have now is inadequate to properly discuss such a profoundly important issue for our case, for this tribunal. We feel it makes a lot of sense. It would be beneficial to all parties and the trial chamber to have an extra written round, maybe after this. However, having said that, I will briefly respond to the submissions from the prosecution and the civil parties, but I will not do so without saying two things first. We never have, nor will we ever, make the argument that under certain circumstances, torture at S21 or Kangtachan was ever justified. We're not making that argument, we will never make that argument. There's an absolute prohibition on torture, there's no doubt about that. Saying that under certain circumstances it is justified, I would argue is an American argument. An argument recently made by the Minister of Defense, Cheney, when it comes to certain prisons. We are not making that argument, that American argument we do not wish to address. That's the first very important point, because the prosecution is riding a very high moral high horse in accusing us of all kinds of things. Secondly, what I find quite astonishing is that we're having a discussion now for about 45 minutes, but we haven't addressed what we feel is by far the most important paragraph of the prosecutor's submissions, and which we see, or we believe, is a complete turnaround of their position, and that is paragraph 18 of their brief. I will get back to paragraph 18 of the brief, but it outlines the way and manners in which an S21 confession from North Zone Deputy Secretary Chor Chan can be used as evidence. It may be in a second round or in written rounds, international co-prosecutors should really be focusing, in our opinion, on this very interesting turnaround in paragraph 18. And of course, what we're also not discussing today is the question of what we have, how we have phrased it, a double standard. Why is it okay to use Krangtachan confessions to prove, as you said, the point that the regime was cruel, but at the same time say that we are not under any circumstances to use such evidence. So these two introductory remarks, I think, are very important to put the whole discussion in a proper legal framework. Now, in the limited time, Mr. President, I have available, I simply want to give some initial reaction to what the prosecution has said, flag some of the significant issues that arise in reaction to this discussion, and hopefully impress upon the chamber that these are questions of enormous magnitude, which we cannot simply deal with in such a rushed and cursory way. Now, to us, it seems the chamber has two roads before it. The first road is the easier one, the road advised by the civil parties and I believe also by the defense of Khieu Samphan. You can simply exclude the use of any possible torture-tainted evidence altogether on the basis that all of it is the fruit of the poisonous tree. I disagree, Judge Fens. I am from a civil law concept, and I believe that we have, in fact, this doctrine, fruits of the poisonous tree, aptly working, because, of course, we also only have professional judges. So this, the doctrine of the fruits of the poisonous tree is something because of the influence of the Strasbourg court, which is not alien to any civil law system. L'influence de la Cour de Strasbourg qui concerne tous les types de tribunaux. The second road is, I think, what we and the prosecution have been discussing so far. And of course, this road is a, we are ready to admit that, a much more slippery slope. Going down this second road would allow the contents of possibly torture-tainted evidence to be used. And then, of course, all sorts of questions arise. What kind of evidence can be used? For what purposes? By which party, and of course also in what way. I think these are very complex questions which deserve detailed consideration and debate. Even the first question as to the kind of evidence that can be used is not that simple. The prosecution, for example, argues that identification evidence given in a confession would not be considered part of its contents, and we believe that this is obviously not necessarily correct. When we move to consider the purpose for which evidence can be used, things get considerably more complicated. For example, our position is that it is necessary to distinguish between evidence used in order to establish the innocence or guilt of the accused and evidence used for other reasons. But here too, of course, complications arise. Because as we have argued in our appeal brief, which is now before the Supreme Court chamber, we believe there is a distinction under the law between who, which party, can use such evidence. And this flows from the permitted purposes for which this evidence can be used. This is what we argued in our appeal brief and last week reiterated in our written submissions to this chamber. In short, it is our view that the law permits us to use such evidence to establish Nunez's innocence, but prohibits the prosecution from using it to establish his guilt. And then, of course, we arrive at the most difficult question of all, and that is, assuming hypothetically that we can permit the contents of possibly tortured, tainted evidence to be used, in what way can we use it? Example. And that is the example, that's actually a perfect example. And that I'm turning now to paragraph 18 of the submissions, the written submissions of the prosecution. Paragraph 18 is about the S21 confession, as I said, of North Zone Deputy Secretary Chor Chan. If you actually look at his confession, there are indeed paragraphs in which he speaks about the alleged Lonol policy of the CPK. However, if you, it is a document, I'm sorry, Mr. President, document E3/3857. It is heavily relied upon in paragraph 18 of the written submissions. If you see at page English ERN 00825306, in French 00850255, and in Khmer 00070803, you see the note has not yet confessed the grounds for having him beaten. It would suggest that he is to be beaten by the interrogator. However, if you see to other pages from this confession, these are ERN 00825261 in English, in French 00850216, and in Khmer 00704038, you see that it says his statement is given, or his confession is given, without torture. Now, notwithstanding the fact that the prosecution has just said that anybody who was in Krang Taichan, even if he was tortured or not, was under duress, we could imagine that this, the same would go true for this particular person. However, the prosecution is using a very particular excerpt from his confession to confirm that indeed a policy to smash Lonol officers was existing. Now, if the prosecution is offering this way of the use of evidence, then of course it would be also possible for the defense to confront any future witnesses, for instance, with parts of his statement or confession in which he says that the traitorous activities of certain people were aimed to sabotage the CPK's economic policy. So we have a very interesting example offered by the prosecution as to how we should use this S21 confession. We believe that under certain circumstances we should be able to ask certain questions to certain witnesses based on this S21 confession. And it seems the prosecution is saying the exact same thing. They can use whichever passage they find relevant and use it as evidence. Which brings me, and these are actually, I think, my final remarks, two people who have been thinking about this issue already quite extensively. And these are not lawyers, but these are two historians. The first one is David Chandler, who has been testifying here as an expert. And the other person who was supposed to testify as an expert but ended up testifying as a witness. A very important person to the prosecution, Steve Heder. Both have said some very interesting things about what one should do in terms of the use of confessions. Now, Mr. President, allow me to quote briefly from Chandler's book, Voices from S21. I refer to English page 0019-2726 in English, Khmer 0019-1882, and in French 0035-7313. And Chandler talks about this overwhelming mass of 5,000 or 6,000 confessions, and what you should do with it. First, and I quote, first, without corroboration from other sources, very few facts, says Chandler, contained in the confessions, aside from strictly autobiographical ones, can be taken at face value. Whether prisoners told the truth under torture, said what they were told to say, said what they thought their interrogators wanted to hear, or produced a mélange of truth, half-truth, and fantasy is impossible to determine. It is safe to assume, however, not only that in their broad outlines most confessions were fabricated to suit what S21 officials assumed to be the wishes of the party center, but, says Chandler, also that strands of genuine conspirational narrative and actual angry conversations are sometimes woven into the confessions. And then comes the interesting part. He then, a little further down, the next page refers to Steve Heder. And he says, and I quote, as Steve Heder has suggested, many of the confessions ring true, even without corroboration. And it would be wrong to label all the prisoners at S21 innocent of involvement in a conspiracy because their confessions contain absurdities, because the regime was evil, or because they were also cruelly treated. So, Chandler and Heder are basically formulating our position. You should be very careful, but under certain circumstances, certain parts of confessions could be used, not necessarily as evidence in the sense of guilt or innocence, but in terms of questioning the witness, witnesses who are upcoming. And I have in front of me, but I'm not sure if I'm allowed to read that to you. This is an excerpt in which I think Steve Heder formulates it extremely aptly. It is an excerpt from an article which is not on the case file. I remember trying to use it when he was... I see you are already No?
Je vois que vous êtes en train de délibérer ou de...
Council, we note it's not on the case file. Second issue, is it actually presenting a confession, the statement you want to read to us?
No, no, it's Chandler is referring to header in a footnote. I just read that part from what is on the case file. Well, I thought it would be very interesting for you to hear what he actually says, what Heather says in his article in terms of the use of those confessions. If you're not interested, then that's fine, but I thought he formulated it quite, quite well.
We have no objection.
L'accusation, nous n'avons pas d'objection.
So Heather is writing this article. Yeah? Heather is writing this article in 1990, and he says, and I quote, once you are confident you understand the literal meaning of the words on the page of the confession, then comes the even more difficult work of deciding to what extent you can believe a word of what you are reading. In principle, you have to assume that you cannot. You have to assume that every word may be either a falsehood forced upon a terrorized writer by his torturing interrogators, or an equal falsehood concocted by the same terrorized writer in some desperate attempt to save his or her life by denying what is true, or parroting some lie that he or she hopes against hope might mollify the organization. And it comes.
D'affaiblir ou de ramollir.
And yet, long before one is through the first 1,000 pages, it becomes obvious to the reader that some things are undoubtedly true. This assessment is based on common sense plausibility and educated intuition. Some things said appear to be undisputedly simple and straightforward statements of fact, which may be taken at face value. At the other end of the spectrum are statements which can be judged with almost as much certainty as being utterly false and fantastic fabrication. However, most of what is said seems to fall somewhere in between. Now, this is exactly formulating our position. We are not here saying that torture is justified, not at all. We are sometimes using, or we would like sometimes to use, very certain parts of either Krangtachan confessions or S21 confessions in order to present our narrative. That is, I think, under these circumstances, a permissible use of evidence which is possibly
torture.
I start with what you quoted from Steve Heather. Well, Steve Heather talks about general things about evaluation of evidence. All of us have done that all our life. I think the issue here is a different one. We are dealing with what I now call an evidentiary rule in the realm of Hughes Cogan's. So let's go back to the legal issue at hand. And I want to give you the opportunity, specifically since this is a public hearing, to perhaps go into a bit more detail as to the reasons for your argument that torture-tainted evidence can be used if it is exculpatory. Now, in order to perhaps structure this a bit, let me point out obvious contradiction. The Convention Against Torture, and I guess everybody has agreed on that, has in the end the objective to end torture, to put it very generally. Now, you are arguing there should be an exemption for exculpatory evidence. That means for the person who actually is the one accused to have tortured. Now, doesn't that go against the very idea of the convention? And secondly, and that's more technical, if the convention would have wanted this exception, wouldn't it be written down? There is an exception in Article 15, but this exception goes into the other direction. It permits tortured evidence under certain circumstances against the accused. So, perhaps, as I said, in the interest also of the public understanding of what you're saying,
I agree with you. The word is all about against the accused. Everybody, I think, in this courtroom would like to have torture eradicated from the world. There's no question about that. And if somebody in his S21 confession confessed something about criminal behavior, or for instance, Kyu Sampan or Nguyen Chia, then there is no doubt at all that that cannot be used under any circumstances. So I think the reading of Article 15, we agreed to almost, I think all parties agreed to almost 80 or 90%. The question is, and that is exactly what the prosecution is doing in order to further its case and the use by the defense. It is about that last, the last piece of use of certain evidence. Prosecution would like to prove the case that at Krang Tachan people were arrested for trivial reasons and then executed. They're using these confessions in order to establish that point. We are using confessions ultimately to find corroboration in respect of our big narrative, the most important point of our defense, that there were in fact two equally strong opposing factions within the Khmer Rouge fighting each other. And the use, for instance, as I have done on the two, in two separate issue cases with Pek Chim and Bun. From Chuchet's confession, one could argue, he said that Som, the Sector 13 person, was a radical person. That is something we're not using as evidence, but as a possible way of asking a witness whether he or she knew something about it. So we're talking about this last part of use of evidence. And I think at the end of the day, the prosecution is asking you to be able to do the same thing as we are. And that is, I think, causing also, having caused this hearing, it's either one standard, meaning not at all, or another standard, and then both parties, with all the caveats, can use certain parts of possibly tortured evidence. I think that is the fundamental issue of the discussion. Prosecution has its case, we have our case, and it's up to you at the end of the day to see whether the arguments based on certain kinds of evidence can be used, yes or no.
Si les arguments à partir de certains éléments de preuve peuvent oui ou non être utilisés.
Counselor Coppé, I understand what you're saying, but don't you think that there is a difference, however, between using the content of confessions to establish that a person is an extremist and using the content of confession simply to say you have been incriminated
without going into la recherche de savoir ce qui est vrai ou pas vrai.
Quest for the truth,
le contenu des éléments de preuve,
content of the evidence is what you wish to establish.
Le reste, c'est un simple fait.
Is a simple fact.
Est-ce que vous pensez pas qu'il y a une différence?
So don't you think that there's a difference here?
Judge Laverne, yes. You will not find,
Juge Laverne, oui.
I can guarantee you this, in our closing submissions, the argument that Som was a radical Maoist, and then we use Chuchet's confession. We will not you will not see us do that. Because we won't touch that. It's too unclear, indeed, whether he was tortured, yes or no. However, signaling something which is of interest to our narrative and then ask a witness whether he or she knew anything about it, I think that is permissible use of this particular part of a confession.
C'est à mon avis un usage qui est autorisé, qui peut être autorisé.
Il me semble quand même que dans l'exemple que vous nous donnez,
what you're trying to do is to corroborate an element of evidence regarding the substance. But we're speaking here about the substance. That's what's at issue. What the prosecutors are saying is different. They're not speaking about the substance. They're speaking simply about a fact.
One of the arguments that we are trying to make, or that we possibly will make, is that certain people in Sector 13 were crazy radical people. Now, as I said, we won't use Tuchet's confession to make that point, but we are able to use that part of his confession as an introduction to other witnesses. That's, at the end of the day, what we are doing. And I agree, it's a slippery slope, but it's not any different from the way the prosecution is, for instance, trying to use the North Zone Secretary's confession from S21.
Des aveux pour la zone nord issue obtenue de S21.
President, thank you, Defense Counsel. The Chamber would like now to hand the floor to the Defense Team for Kyiv Saint-Paul.
You can proceed, Counsel.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Une fois n'est pas coutume, nous n'avons pas la même vision des choses que nos confrères de l'équipe de Nouméa, mais nous n'avons pas non plus la même position que l'accusation. Rappelons le texte, il a été relu par Monsieur le coprocureur ce matin. L'article 15 de la Convention contre la torture est clair. Tout État veille à ce que toute déclaration dont il était établi qu'elle a été obtenue par la torture ne puisse être invoqué comme un élément de preuve dans une procédure, si ce n'est contre la personne accusée de torture, pour établir qu'une déclaration a été faite. Point. Pour établir qu'une déclaration a été faite, un point, un trait. Pas plus, pas moins. Et ce que j'entends aujourd'hui de l'autre côté de la barre, c'est un élargissement de cette règle, en disant que quelque part il y aurait une utilisation noble du contenu de confession et une utilisation qui serait vile et illégale de la part de la défense. Pour moi, il est très clair que cet article 15 de la Convention contre la torture, qui a été rédigé par des éminents juristes qui savaient très bien ce qu'ils faisaient, a bien indiqué que le seul motif pour lequel on peut utiliser une déclaration faite sous la torture, c'est pour établir qu'une déclaration a été faite. Point. Pas le contenu, quel qu'il soit. Alors j'entends bien que ce soit pour la défense ou pour l'accusation, que des parties de confession puissent nous être utiles dans le cadre de la présentation de nos thèses aux uns et aux autres. Mais on ne peut pas. On ne le peut pas. C'est dit, c'est clairement dit et ça a été rappelé. Ça a été rappelé par la chambre préliminaire de cette juridiction. Rappelons-le lorsqu'il était question au niveau de l'instruction de savoir si on pouvait utiliser une partie ou pas une partie de ces confessions. Voilà ce qui a été dit dans la décision D130-10-12 du 27 janvier 2010 au paragraphe 28. On dit bien Nonobstant toute indication du contraire avancée par les co-juges d'instruction dans l'ordonnance, les termes de l'article 15 de la Convention contre la torture doivent faire l'objet d'une application stricte. Il n'y a lieu ni de se prononcer sur la véracité du contenu d'une déclaration obtenue sous la torture, ni d'en faire tout autre usage. Et ce que vous demande aujourd'hui l'accusation, c'est d'en faire un autre usage. Et ce n'est pas acceptable. Aujourd'hui, on vous dit, mais attention, on ne veut pas utiliser le contenu des confessions pour dire que c'est vrai. On veut vous dire simplement que le fait est avéré, à savoir que, par exemple, pour Krenk Tachan, on a voulu arrêter telle personne ou on a torturé telle personne parce qu'elle a volé une banane. Je pourrais prendre l'exemple à ce moment-là pour la défense et dire, si mon confrère de l'équipe de Nunchea veut utiliser le contenu d'une confession, non pas pour prouver que c'est vrai, mais pour dire, eh bien oui, l'interrogateur, dans le cadre de cette confession, voulait savoir s'il y avait effectivement des traîtres au niveau de cette zone. Il ne s'agit pas de dire que c'est vrai qu'il y avait eu des traîtres, mais simplement de dire que, par cette question, on prouve que la raison de la torture et la raison de l'arrestation, c'est de prouver qu'on recherchait des gens pour ce motif-là et qu'on pouvait torturer des gens pour ce motif-là. Quelle est la différence entre le but recherché par l'accusation et le but recherché par la défense dans ces cas-là? Aucune, si ce n'est, encore une fois, que là nous avons une sorte de filtre moral qui est de dire « Ah mais comme c'est l'accusation qui veut prouver quelque chose pour le bien-être des victimes ou pour le bien-être de sa cause, ça, ce serait admissible. Mais comme c'est la défense qui demande, encore une fois, sur le même fondement, hein, pas prouver que c'est vrai, simplement prouver que l'interrogateur recherchait ce type d'information. Ce n'est pas admissible. C'est peut-être tentant pour nous, en tant qu'avocats, parce qu'on estime qu'on a besoin d'avoir des éléments et que ce serait le début d'un commencement de preuve, etc. Mais ce n'est pas admissible en application stricte de l'article 15 de la Convention sur la torture. Un point aussi de clarification, parce qu'il me semble que Monsieur le co-procureur a lu partiellement nos écritures qui sont brefs pourtant, mais en français, donc on va dire que c'est peut-être ce qu'il n'a pas compris. La position de l'équipe de Kyo-Sampan est encore plus forte que cela, puisque nous estimons qu'en application du droit cambodgien et du fait qu'en l'absence de règles précises dans le cadre du règlement de preuve, il y a un alignement avec la pratique internationale. Nous soumettons que l'application des règles des déclarations obtenues par la torture sont également applicables pour les confessions obtenues sous la contrainte. Et si, effectivement, Monsieur le coprocureur avait bien compris notre argumentation, il aurait compris que lorsque nous avons évoqué le cas de Van Saroon dans nos écritures, nous avons indiqué que si, au sens pur du terme, il ne pouvait pas y avoir, on ne pouvait pas dire qu'il y avait une torture physique de Van Saroon, si nous considérons ces déclarations exactes, il y avait tout le moins de la contrainte, à savoir une peur de sa part. Et l'article 38 de la Constitution cambodgienne est clair, et l'article 321 du Code de procédure pénale du Royaume du Cambodge le dit précisément. L'aveu, comme tout autre mode de preuve, est soumis à l'appréciation du tribunal. Mais il précise également, les déclarations obtenues sous la contrainte physique ou morale sont sans valeur probante. Donc là également, pour nous, il y a un alignement entre les déclarations obtenues sous la torture ou sous la contrainte. Alors qu'il soit clair que de ce côté de la barre, il ne s'agit pas de dire que certaines thèses ou certains points ne peuvent pas être avancés. Ils peuvent être avancés, et je vais rebondir sur l'exemple pris ce matin par Monsieur le coprocureur, et il nous explique le cas de Kyo Sampan évoqué dans une confession en indiquant « Nous voulons utiliser ces documents comme preuve que Duc, que nous avons interrogé, a eu reçu pour instruction d'écarter les confessions. Parce que nous voulons prouver que, même lorsque le nom de Kyo Sampan se trouve dans les confessions, on peut décider de les écarter. »
Mais
l'accusation, à ce moment-là, a la simple possibilité d'interroger Duc. Il n'a pas besoin de se référer à des documents qui sont teintés, à des documents qui sont, dont l'utilisation est prohibée en application de l'article 15 de la Convention de la torture, parce que ce n'est pas marqué dans l'article 15 de la Convention qu'on peut utiliser le contenu pour corroborer, etc. Non, on dit simplement que c'est pour établir qu'une déclaration a été faite. Et pour établir qu'une déclaration a été faite, il y a seulement deux éléments qui sont nécessaires. Le nom de la personne éventuellement interrogée, la date, et éventuellement, troisièmement, le lieu où ça s'est effectué. C'est tout. On n'a pas besoin d'aller dans le contenu de la déclaration, et ce n'est pas seulement qu'on n'a pas besoin d'y aller, on n'a pas le droit d'y aller. Encore une fois, ça peut être frustrant parce qu'on peut estimer que ces éléments permettent de nourrir notre thèse, mais c'est une règle qui doit s'appliquer indifféremment à l'égard de l'accusation et à l'égard de la défense. C'est une question de principe. Et là, j'en reviens à cette histoire de principe, parce que lorsque on essaye de voir quelle est l'utilisation éventuelle que l'on peut faire de ces déclarations, nous ne sommes pas dans le cadre d'une thèse d'histoire, nous sommes dans une enceinte judiciaire, qui doit avoir une intégrité de sa procédure. Et avoir des documents teintés par la torture, c'est une attaque à l'intégrité de cette procédure, en dehors même du principe basique de la question de la fiabilité. Ça, c'était les éléments que je voulais faire valoir sur le fond. Maintenant, sur une autre question qui était importante, et je crois que M. le juge Lavergne y a répondu en partie, à savoir sur les confessions S21. Effectivement, il y a des décisions qui ont été prises dans le cadre du jugement Duc. Vous êtes parvenu à certaines conclusions. Mais c'est un procès dans lequel ni M. Kyo Sampan ni M. Nunchea n'étaient partis. Ils n'ont pu faire valoir leurs éléments de preuve. Et de fait, vous avez pu aboutir à des conclusions qui ne sont pas opposables en tant que telles aux accusés dans ce box. Et j'en veux pour preuve un exemple, le paragraphe 332 de votre jugement du 7 août 2014, par lequel vous êtes revenu sur la conclusion que vous aviez prise dans le cadre du procès Duc, où vous indiquiez que Nunchea aurait été membre du comité militaire, et dans le cadre de votre jugement dans le procès 02-1, avec d'autres éléments de preuve, vous êtes parvenu à une conclusion différente. Cela pour dire qu'il n'y a pas de présomption en tant que telle. Il convient d'appliquer un standard de revue de la preuve et des éléments. Si les parties entendent utiliser des éléments et qu'elles considèrent que ces éléments-là ne sont pas entachés de la torture, c'est des choses qui se discutent dans le cadre de cette enceinte judiciaire, mais il n'y a aucune présomption qui soit opposable aux uns et aux autres sans débat judiciaire au sein de cette salle d'audience dans ce procès-ci. Pour terminer, je rappelle simplement que nous demandons une application stricte de l'article 15 de la Convention contre la torture, qu'il n'y a pas lieu, quel que soit le contenu de ces confessions, d'utiliser ce contenu, que seuls les éléments basiques, et quand j'entends les éléments basiques relatifs à l'identité de la personne interrogée, il ne s'agit pas de l'intégralité de la biographie, comme j'ai cru le comprendre des écritures des coprocureurs, parce que, soyons clairs, on sait très bien où ils veulent en venir. ça peut aider à leur thèse d'avoir tout un narratif de la biographie familiale de certaines confessions pour corroborer leur thèse. Mais là encore, si on estime qu'il y a effectivement des informations qui ont été obtenues par la torture dans le cadre de ces biographies, nous ne savons pas et nous ne pouvons pas savoir si ces éléments sont vrais ou faux. Nous ne pouvons pas non plus savoir. Ça a été également un élément qui a été évoqué dans le cadre de l'interrogatoire de Von Sarun. Nous ne pouvons pas savoir ce qui est de la main pure et simple de l'interrogateur ou ce qui ressortirait des aveux éventuels forcés de la personne interrogée. En tout état de cause, le contenu ne saurait être un élément utilisé dans le cadre de ce procès, le contenu d'une confession au sens de l'article 15 de la Convention sur la torture ne peut être utilisé. Il y a une seule exception, on l'a dit et tout le monde l'a bien lu et relu. La seule exception, c'est établir qu'une déclaration a été faite. Un point, un trait.
President, you may now proceed, Judge Fentz.
Yes, I have two questions. The first one is again to the standard.
Tout d'abord, encore en lien
when
avec
is it established? You appear to indicate that even factual findings in a final verdict, factual findings to the effect that torture has happened, for instance in S21, in a verdict, don't meet the standard. Because they were against other accused, which I don't think plays a role for the question of standard here. So, if this doesn't meet your requirements of standard, what does? Any comments on the standard issue? And as Judge Laverne pointed out, on the exact opposite scale of the whole thing, the European Court appears, at least in one decision, to have established a very low standard, or comparatively low standard, namely substantial risk. And the second question is, you mentioned Article 321 of the Cambodian Procedural Code. Were you trying to argue that the Torture Convention, as it is implemented in Cambodian law, is actually wider, or in Cambodian law it's actually wider because it's not only torture, but it also covers, statements made under physical and mental duress. Thank you.
Pour répondre à votre première question, je ne sais pas s'il y a eu un problème de traduction ou peut-être que je n'ai pas été claire. Lorsque je parlais du principe de l'autorité de la chose jugée, je disais simplement que ce n'est pas parce que vous avez abouti à certaines conclusions dans le jugement, enfin quand je dis vous n'étiez pas dans le panel de délibération du jugement double, mais je veux dire simplement que ce n'est pas parce que certaines conclusions ont été faites dans double qu'elles sont automatiquement opposable aux accusés dans ce procès-là. Donc ça, c'était ce seul point parlant de il n'y a autorité de la chose jugée qu'entre même partie au procès. Ce n'est pas le cas. Voilà. Ça, c'était la clarification. Et le deuxième point, oui, effectivement, l'article 321 du Code pénal cambodgien est plus large en ce qu'il fait effectivement état des déclarations obtenues sous la contrainte morale ou physique de façon un peu plus large que l'article 15 stricto sensu. J'espère avoir répondu à
Le président.
Thank you for your oral submission.
Merci in relation to the use of tortured tainted evidence. L'utilisation des éléments de preuve extorqués
and
sous
we
la
have heard from party whether tortured tainted evidence can be used in our case 002/02. The chamber will take all your comments and observations into consideration
and
the chamber will respond and decide on the request made by the party. It is now convenient time for a short break, and the chamber will take break from now until 11:15. And when we resume, we will hear 2TCW851.
The court is now in recess. Suspension de l'audience.